If you ask me what's the best handheld console, my answer is the first handheld I own. The Game Boy Advance is the third and final Nintendo handheld line with the Game Boy name. Many people would recommend the definitive SP model because it's backlit and more compact, but I like the original design better for the nostalgic value. I used to have three of these. One of them is white, the other one is more platinum, and the other is a translucent blue kind. But two of them broke, and the last one I had to sell that, because financial reasons. But at least I have my portable PS1 known as the Vita, which I blatantly jailbroke because why not? Even though this is a video tied about my favorite gem series, we have to talk about these hidden Game Boy Advance gems. But I'll save you the rest of the bollocks because the original intro is about 4 minutes long. So, here's my top 10 favorite Game Boy Advance gems. Today's emulator will be the Visual Boy Advance. It's an excellent Game Boy Advance emulator which also runs Game Boy and Game Boy Color games. Also, this is the very first video on this channel that runs on the Covenant at 60fps format. All because I'm using the built-in recorder but renders the Game Boy Advance's original resolution. In other words, it's a bit crappy and blurry, hence the small footage size and chance for the audio to desynchronize itself. So let's bust a move and get it started, shall we? So to start this list, we have an obscure game, made by an obscure company, and published by another obscure company, and all of them didn't last very long. This is the tale of Lady Sia on Game Boy Advance. This game was made by RFX and published by TDK Media Active in October 2001, 4 months after the Game Boy Advance's international release. Outside Japan, that is. So, if any of you don't know who TDK is, they are an electronics company who's popular for making cassettes at one point. Their video game division didn't last very long because they made and published a few games. And one of them is that awful, god-awful Aquaman game. Yeah. So you play as this cocky as fuck warrior princess named Sia, who has to defeat a race of evil furries known as the Soas, who are created by an evil warlock named Oniman. Her quest leads to several realms where you have to rescue prisoners, kill furries, fly around with your bird, kill more furries, die by touching the fucking thorns, boss fights, you know, typical 2D platformer stuff. The intro cutscene to this game is impressive, and the game's graphics looks pretty hand-drawn, which is nice. You also have the ability to sneak around, climb on platforms without jumping at the edges, and shoot projectiles. Also beat 'em up elements, but there's barely any of that. You could also get more abilities by completing certain levels, and these can be somewhat handy at times. I'm not really sure because I haven't got through with it yet. Even though it's an early Game Boy Advance game, it has some flaws, like the difficulty and bad music, for instance. But the biggest one for me that drives me crazy is the sound design. No, we're not talking about the music. You probably think the sounds are annoying or rapey, but no, not really. What really drives me crazy is that I'm expecting sounds of getting hit, landing, enemies attacking, falling objects, etc. And guess what? There's none of those. Then again, it's an early Game Boy Advance game, what do you expect? The 9 other games are actually superior when it comes to gameplay and sound design. That's why Lady C is at number 10. Yeah, it was a little bit harsh, but it has some unique charm to it, really. Apparently, she's supposed to have her own series, and one of them was going to be on the PS2, but all of them are shit can due to the lack of interest. Sadly, RFX and TDK bit the dust in 2003 and 2004. TDK was acquired by Take-Two Interactive, who's the parent company of the best gaming publishers out there, Rockstar and 2K Games. So, if you want a better explanation on this game, I recommend checking out CGR Undertow's take on this game. It's good. So imagine you're 6, and the year was December 2002. Your parents went to your local Walmart, or Zellers, and your mom told you to pick one game because they're parents. The games on the shelves looks appealing from the box art, and there's that one game that stands out. Not because it looks awesome or anything, but it's more of the weird territory. That is Carnage Rally. Okay, you're probably thinking that one of my favorite gens is a piece of shit from the looks of it, but there's a lot of great games that has some atrocious cover art, like the Sega Master System games with their shitty grids on it, Mega Man on NES, and the Game of the Year edition of Arkham City, to name a few. But when you look at the North American cover for Carnage Rally, you be like, nope. Of course, the game is notorious for its box art and dumb title. Yeah, Carnage. Carnage. The fuck is Carnage? But the game itself is pretty decent. It reminds me of Death Rally on DOS. So it's a top-down racing game with some vehicular combat in the mix. It also has some pretty nice graphics for its time, and some polygonal objects to get the 3D feel. You start driving some comical Flintstone cars, and one of them is actually called Rolling Rock, by the way. And you race on prehistoric tracks. And no, they're not Flintstone themed. So you compete championships, choose better cars, race on more modern tracks, betting, upgrading, and so on. The sounds for the cars are pretty much the same as every other car in the game, and the music is not so great in my opinion. But better than Lady Sia, I can tell you that much. You can also run over people and seals in this game. Yeah. Rated E for everyone. Overall, Carnage is a misunderstood game that lacks appreciation, and one of the many examples of never judge a book by its cover. Or never judge a game by its box art. I mean, look at the Japanese Saturn cover for Gex. Looks derpy as fuck. There was some controversy that some hypocrite who wrote for EGM reviewed this game based on the US cover alone, and didn't actually play it. But at least, this game was re-released on Android phones in 2007 as K-Rally. It's pretty much the same game, but with a better title. And, yeah, there's another racing game on here, just a heads up. Back when Konami is actually good, this is a Hideo Kojima game. Well, actually, it's directed and written by Kuo Nakamura, but Kojima produced it. Boktai is one of those unique Game Boy games that has its own special cartridge. And no, it's not a colored one like Pokemon. We're talking the abnormally shaped but official ones with unique properties to it, like the Game Boy camera and Kirby's Tilt and Tumble. This cartridge here has a solar sensor on it, and guess what? The gimmick here is that you use the solar sensor to actually charge your weapon, which is powered by the fucking sun!
Lend me your energy, son! Please!
Boktai: The Sun Is In Your Hand is an isometric RPG where you play as Django, not Jamie Foxx, but some kid who shoots the fuck out of the undead, immortals, and other deities with your Gundel soul, while having a talking sunflower named Master Otenko as your ally. Speaking of the Gundel soul, it's a unique weapon which is also customizable, kinda like the constructor weapons from Ratchet & Clank Future, but with more purpose. Even though it's an RPG and stuff, there's some stealth elements for variety, puzzles to solve, upgrading to, well, kill enemies quicker, and deep story to keep you engaged. The gameplay feels right, the music's great, and the sound in general is completely clear and none of that grainy static noise in the background. Even though the game is pretty fun, the gun itself can be a bit of an issue because it has a tendency to overheat if you rely this over stealth. But the thing that sucks in this game is that if you're playing this at night, or the solar sense is broken, or doing emulation like I did, you're going to have a bad time because you need the powers of the actual sun and utilize solar items to play this. Emulating this game without a certain fan made patch will make this game impossible to beat, because I learned that the hard way. At least there's three more Boktai games. The third one is Japanese exclusive, and the fourth one is on the DS, known as Lunar Knights, but they threw away the solar sensor because it's a DS game. So if you want the full authentic experience, I highly recommend getting the physical copy for these games. It's worth your time. So, another obscure game by obscure companies which didn't last very long. This time, both of them are so obscure, there's no Wikipedia page about them. This is CT Special Forces by Hip Interactive and developed by LSP in 2001. It's one of those run-and-gun games where you play as a no-name soldier, shooting the fuck out of bad guys with added writing and such. This game is also on the PS1, complete with full-motion video. If anyone played the PlayStation version, it's pretty much the same, without some effects and such. The graphics are more cartoonish, the levels are pretty big, some levels are actually helicopter segments, some sections have skydiving bits and sniping bits, some enemy variety, and boss fights at the end. The music's upbeat, and the sound effects are pretty mediocre. So while watching the gameplay, what does it remind you of? If you guessed Metal Slug, you're in the ballpark. But what I heard that Metal Slug is faster paced. Even the Game Boy Advance version was like that. Some things in this game that sucks is that you only have a handful of weapons. No melee attacks. Enemies can be a bit cheap. Enemies are also tougher in each world. I mean, the fourth one requires 10 shots or 2 grenades to kill one guy. And that's a goon. The sniping sections is a pain in the ass, and no solid save feature, except using passwords. But at least the game is short. I can give it that much. I wouldn't recommend this game if you actually play Metal Slug. If you didn't, try this first, because it's a bit easier. Then play them next. So unlike Lady Sia, Counter-Terrorist Special Forces has a few more games. Being Back Into the Trenches, or Back Into Hell. The third one being Bioterror, or Navy SEALs. And the fourth one is Fire of Effect, which is a 3D game on PS2, PC, and Xbox. But what I heard of that thing is pretty shitty. But I'd check out the second and third game if I had a chance. Hey look! Another treasure game! This time it's based off the OG anime. No, we're not talking about that anime, no. We're talking about this anime. Astro Boy. Also known as the real OG of anime. So this is based off the 2003 remake of the show, developed by Treasure and Sega Hitmaker, published by Sony Pictures, Sega, and Tezuka Productions in 2003 and 2005, it's a beat-em-up game where you play as none other than Astro Boy, who has to save the world from imminent evil and racism. You'll get the idea when you play this. I'm not going to give you too much of the story because I just skim-read through this. Because ain't nobody got time for that. Kill me some robots, goddammit! Then all I got is a variety of robots to kick ass. Like big ones, very small ones, and a large plethora of boss fights. Other than beating shit up, there's also some shmup sections as well. but it feels a bit cheap when destroying everything with your finger laser as the norm. You also have super abilities where you unleash a massive laser beam out of your arm, butt guns, or Superman punch your enemies. There's also some RPG elements where you upgrade your stuff by meeting characters from the show. And that aside, the graphics looks great, the gameplay is hectic, the music's fine, and the sound is good. But some criticism for this is that it has some major slowdown. Like if there is too much shit on screen, it's going to be slow, like The Matrix, but can be handy if you're in a tight spot. Another bit of criticism is that it's pretty damn hard, and I'm just playing this on normal mode, by the way. And don't get me started on Pluto. Other than that, it's a blast to play, and very rewarding if you manage to defeat the most toughest of bosses, even Pluto. Even though the game and anime have their own struggles in the West, the other parts of the world had no problem with that. So if you're an Astro Boy fan, get it. It's worth adding to your collection. Klonoa. This strange cat-rabbit thing is one of gaming's most underrated heroes, on the likes of Vibri, Rocket, and Gex, who many thought he moved on to Geico commercials. Klonoa has an entire series based around him, since the likes of PlayStation to the Wii remake. But I think I know why he's pretty overlooked. Okay, not really, because I want to say that a lot of cover art for these games are not that appealing. But the real reason, however, is the lack of advertising. So, this edition here is Klonoa Empire of Dreams on Game Boy Advance, and here's a grim fact for ya. The North American version was released in, I kid you not, the same day the 9/11 attacks occurred. So Klonoa Empire of Dreams works like your average everyday 2D side-scrolling puzzle platformer, but with the ability to grab and throw your enemies, or use them as extra jumpy distance. The story takes place when Klonoa wakes up in the Empire of Julius. It was confronted by the Emperor, who suffers from insomnia. You venture off to 5 different worlds, and enter Visions, as the game calls the levels. Each world has several platforming puzzle levels, a snowboarding section, an auto-scrolling level, and a boss to defeat. The graphics looks pretty great, the music is appropriate, and the challenge is well balanced. I can give one bit of criticism, that is that the auto-scrolling levels are brutal as hell if you're trying to collect all 100 Dreamstones in one go. I forgot to tell you that this is also a collectathon, by the way. Other than that, it's a comfy game to play when you're bored. It also has a sequel which I didn't get the chance to play, but both the original and the sequel are on the Wii U Virtual Console. Even though Klonoa is the most popular series on this list, and has been on some several games, plus very small cameos, he's always seemed to get obscured by other games at the time. For example, Door to Phantom Isle was obscured by Gran Turismo and Final Fantasy VII. The Game Boy Advance releases were obscured by Mario Kart Super Circuit and Rayman Advance, or insert DS game here. Lunatee's Vale, obscured by Sly Cooper and Ratchet & Clank. And the remake was obscured by Infamous and Call of MLG, Modern Doritos 2, Mountain Dugaloo. You know, I kind of feel bad about this guy, because he wants to be well known from the likes of Mario and Pac-Man. I mean, he has Pac-Man on his hat, right? Maybe he's already well known in the underground aspect of all things. But I haven't seen him since the Wii remake. But the question is he done for? Or chances are he will be rebooted as some sort of spiritual successor on a Kickstarter project like Ukulele? We may never know. That, or some asshole should have put on some advertising for these games. Come on! Thank you. say what you want, I'm not really a fan of space shmups. To me, and take this with a grain of salt, it kind of feels the same way you pilot a spaceship and shoot the fuck out of everything in sight since the likes of Xevious, Radius, and R-Type. Of course, there's some differences such as the 3D shooter, change the angles, replace the spaceship into a little witch girl that shoots magic, bullet to hell, Truxton! Make a parody that looks very suggestive, or anything that's Japanese. If you're expecting a space shmup that contains everything I said, well, you'll be disappointed. Except for the 3D part. So here's another space shmup by another obscure game company which I thought was Japanese in hindsight, but it's actually a German company who's known for making the closest thing to a new F-Zero game on the Wii U. So this is Iridian 3D and Iridian 2 by Shinen Multimedia. Why both games? Because they're awesome. Both games look fucking amazing with those 3D graphics, but that's all pre-rendered. I mean, we have some 3D Game Boy Advance games that ranges from this to this. I think some objects from Iridian and Iridian 2 are actually 3D though. Anyways, the gameplay for the first game is a 3D perspective, like Space Harrier or Afterburner. While the second one is more of a top-down perspective, where you have full reign like Truxton. The first game plays like your average space shooter where you collect power-ups and such while shooting the fuck out of everything, while the second one allows you to collect weapons, change weapons, manually upgrade, while shooting the fuck out of everything. The soundtracks for both games are the best on this list. My favorite of the bunch is the boss music from Iridian 2. Some criticism was needed other than your average shmup is that the first game is pretty hard, and Amy is a pain in the ass while the second game is much easier, with three difficulty modes. Both of these games doesn't have a save feature but uses passwords instead. But that's just me being a fucking brat, but luckily, I'm playing this on an emulator, and emulators have save states. Despite the game with the best sounds and graphics on the Game Boy Advance has to offer, it's pretty good for the shmup fans, but if you find a copy for these games, buy them. Even though this is number 4 on my list, the next 3 may not be the best looking games on there, but they play pretty damn good. Okay, this is the last racing game made by a company you never heard of, because they only made exactly 3 games. Also, this is the other racing game which I mentioned not so long ago. This is Racing Gears Advance by Canadian-based developer and publishing studio Orbital Media. It's an isometric racer which is pretty much overlooked from the other racers such as GT Advance and Mario Kart. So in this game, you can drive various licensed vehicles such as the Lotus Elise, the Chevy SSR, or my personal favorite, the Dodge Viper. Each one has their own special abilities. The championship mode consists of 5 cups, plus a custom one. The gameplay is faster and much smoother than Carnage Rally. You could race with 7 different opponents, or link up with 3 other people. The controls are great, and has some great music too. So good, I used one of the songs when I talked about Top Gear Overdrive last list, because possible copyright reasons with Grindstone. Tracks themselves are varied, like a street track, a dirt track, a snow track, etc., complete with sun and rain variations, plus shortcuts. But similar to Carnage Rally, it has some car combat elements and upgrading, but they're more expansive. Even though the graphics may be fine, there's some bits that kinda irritate me, like the somewhat confusing environments, texture seems blocky, and various obstructions. But then again, if you're playing this on real hardware, it's not that bad. Also, another nuisance is when you complete a championship, you get more tracks. But that's for the car you compete with. So it's like a reverse rush too, when you unlock cars for particular tracks, but instead, you unlock particular tracks for particular cars. Yeah, you get the idea here. Overall, it's a great racing game worth checking out. There was going to be a sequel for the game on both the Game Boy Advance and DS, but both are cancelled. From the looks of it, I can say that Orbital didn't last in the long run. Drill Dozer is the latest game on this list because the North American version was released in February of 2006. Created by the same company who made Pokemon, it's another Game Boy Advance game with its own unique cartridge. But this time, it's like a built-in rumble pack. But useless because... playing via emulation. So what you do here is drill until you pierce the heavens. Well, if that's the case, I'm done. But not really. So in Drill Dozer, you play as a little girl named Jill, a young leader of a small group of bandits known as the Red Dozers, who has to retrieve their red diamond which was stolen by another group of bandits known as the Skulkers, while avoiding the police. You pilot this gunman, Drill Dozer, to get through many obstacles, from walls, blocks, and your enemies. You start with one gear, which is a small burst of drilling action, until you have to collect two more gears, which makes you unstoppable. You can upgrade this thing, which allows you to drill harder blocks, increase health, and buy extra levels. So after I told you the basics, the gameplay is great, the combat is not so challenging, and the boss fights are a bit crazy. The music's also great, and it changes when you collect the third gear, which will be annoying after a few levels. So what kind of sucks is that the challenge is a bit too easy and a little short. But at least buying extra levels in a hard mode could add extra replayability. Other than that, this game deserves a sequel or remake. The game was popular enough that Jill herself was in Super Smash Bros. Brawl as an assist trophy, and the game was re-released on the Wii U Virtual Console like Klonoa did. Also, spoilers, but that's not story-based. Beating the game allows you to buy the strongest drill in the game, which could drill metal blocks, by the way. And that can be used to access the secret room in the training level, which has a 4-digit block, by the way. Plugging in the correct level code and their combinations grants some in-game secrets, like wallpapers, costumes, etc. Now you made her wear a frog costume, because why not? Worth it. Strike Super Slam Alpha Turbo Plus Tournament Edition and Knuckles. I'm just kidding, no. Something less ridiculous, more stable, and existent than a Smash Bros. Clone with Shrek characters on it. And Knuckles. How about a ninja? And no, we're not talking about that Naruto shit. Those can fuck off. We're talking the OG kind of ninjas. Who is also a cop? Where you fight terrorism, other ninjas, and samurai warriors. This is Ninja 5-0, or Ninja Cop if you live in Europe. Yes, we have another game by the pachinko fuckers at Konami, but it's really good. It's a side-scrolling action game where you kill terrorists, rescue hostages, and defeat their evil leaders. You have a good amount of equipment ranging from your trusty ninja sword, shurikens which can be powered up, ninpo, binoculars, and your grappling hook so you can act like Spider-Man. Seems easy enough, until it starts to kick your ass after a few levels. I mean, this game is NES hard, and I'm just playing this on normal mode. There's also a hard mode and a time trial mode where you complete levels as fast as you can. At least the game gives you the courtesy of infinite lives though, which is nice. There's also a variety of enemies to kill ranging from knife-wielding goons, and pyros to the big samurai fuckers with boomerangs and grenade launchers. You also have to rescue the hostages, but killing them reduces your health, or just flat out kills you with disarmament. The grappling hook requires some practice to get used to. In some places, you can get killed if you're not careful enough. Overall, the controls are great, the graphics are good, and the music gives this cheesy action B-movie feel, which is great. So what are the downsides? Well, other than the difficulty, it's the sales. It sucks. So yeah, it's not getting a sequel because of said sales, but this is a very fun experience to play. If you find a copy for this at a thrift store, I highly recommend getting it. Konami or not, this is my favorite Game Boy Advance game right here, with the arcadey gameplay and all. Even though it has a story, I didn't feel like reading through. Also, this game makes a great tool-assisted speedrun. As of now, I'm putting my favorite gem series on hold because I have other things to do, like equipment to buy and art to make. So my name is Mace the Omnilusion, and I'll see you next time.